Well, my name is Felicity, as you heard. And a couple of days ago, a team member of the Creative Morning team, she called me and she asked me if I wanted to do this talk. And I asked her, what's the team? And she said, it's about death. And to be honest, I was not really comfortable with me doing this talk, the idea of it, because first of all, I never did a talk before. And I'm also a little bit not sure about my English, especially when I'm nervous. And the third thing is, I realized that if I'm going to tell about my project, I also have to be a little bit open about who I am and why I made this project and my own experience with death, because somehow death really is a big part of my life the last 5 years. I lost a couple of people, so I really had to deal with that. And actually, 5 years ago, my grandmother died, and she left me just a small amount of money. And I never made pictures before, but somehow I had the feeling that I should buy a camera of the money. So I did, and I was just capturing little moments of my daily life, and I was glad I bought the camera, because I felt by making these pictures I could reflect on my own inner world, and it was good to do. And a couple of months later, I applied for art school, and so that's how I became a photography student, and it was really nice because I really fitted in, and the creative process I really liked. And 1.5 years later, my uncle died. And I also really had a good connection with him. He really motivated me to do to apply for art school and things. So, that's also a picture. So of course, death really influenced the way I look to life, and also me making work. And so I made this project about losing memories, because I was really afraid that I would lose my memories of him. And we didn't have any pictures together. So what I did, I just reproduced my memories, and I made photos of it. And of course, the absence is you can see the absence, because he's not there in any of these pictures. I not only make pictures, but I like installation. I like to work with different materials and also different kind of media. So 1.5 years later, I had to do an internship. So I went to New York. It was really great. And I wanted to visit the 9/11 memorial. And the first thing I saw, I was really surprised by the behavior of the visitors, because they were making selfies all the time, and they were yelling at each other, and it was just really strange. So with that in mind, I went back to the Netherlands after I done an internship. And I wanted to make a project about it. And so I was doing this research, and I found an article of Alexandra Delano and Benjamin Nines, and they wrote a great research. They did a great research and wrote a great article about missing names on the 9/11 memorial. So when I read it, I was really shook. I thought, are there missing names on the 9/11 memorial, and why? How did it came? And that's when I started my project, Either Not Dead or Does Not Exist. And it's I have to explain a little bit why there are missing names on the 9/11 memorial. I made this video installation. I think you have to know that, because I will explain how I made it and why I made it like that. But Well, okay, first of all, I made this commitment to myself. I said, okay, if I'm going to start this project, I really have to do big research. And I was also kind of scared because I thought, how is it possible that a young woman from the Netherlands is going to do this project? I mean, you have to know a lot. And I said to myself, you don't have to tell everything you know, but you have to know everything to tell what you want to tell. And so first of all, I just sent out emails to people. I sent an email to Alexandra Delano, who wrote research. And she was really kind to me. I just explained her that I wanted to make a project about this topic. And she said, if you're coming to New York, we will have a talk and I will tell you everything. And she sent it, the whole research. And I also tried to make contact with Joel McGowan. He is the executive director of the TPIAC Association. And that's an association who really helps Mexican people living in New York with just normal things like English lessons or work or that kind of stuff. So, so I had to collect all this data and this information. And I also contacted Victor Tong, who is a forensic scientist, and he did also 3 years of research on the identification process and how everything went. I'm gonna give you some numbers and some facts so you understand more about how this happened, that people are not on the memorial. So as you see, there are 2,753 officially recognized victims, and all these names are in the memorial. And you can separate this group of victims, I think, in two groups. Victims, the employer confirmed that the victim was there at the moment that the attacks happened. And they also found body remains of the victim, so there was like a plus match. And you also have the victims who are recognized, but a lot of people don't know that from 1/3 of the officially recognized victims, they didn't find any bodily remains. So for 1,300 people, they only on the memorial because their employer confirmed they were there, but they didn't find anything. So that's just what I said. If something is not clear, if you want to ask something, just ask, because I did this project for 2 years, so I have it all in my head, and sometimes I forget that I forget to tell things. Or... So, on one hand, you have all these victims, and on the other hand, you have the remains they found it. And 38%, so 7,652 remains, they could not be matched with the official list of the victims. And that's because a couple of reasons. It could be a baby in the womb of a mother, or it also could be that the relatives of the victim didn't want to give out any DNA to be matched, because, for example, if your dad died, but he was not your biological dad, and they would try to match with you as a son, and you didn't know your dad was not your biological dad, it would be strange to not having a match, for example. But also that the DNA could be too damaged to match, and or the victim didn't have any family left to give out any DNA, or the families couldn't give any DNA because they were abroad or it was just too difficult. So then the question arises, what if your employer did not confirm that you were there during the attacks and no body remains were found? Because I talk about a group of the undocumented immigrants who also worked there that day, of course. course, because they are everywhere in America, and a lot of them worked in the restaurants. And their relatives could not prove that their loved one died that day because they were not registered. They didn't have any documents or they had false papers. And as we saw, it's really likely that if you was there that day, that your body just vanished. Because also from one third of the officially recognized victims, they didn't find anything. So when I found out about this, I was really confused that I thought, oh, of course, it's very logical if you think about it that there were undocumented immigrants also that day. And the first thing I mentioned was that I was looking for official documents about it, because we have all these thousands of interviews of the victims, but I could only find one little small interview of a woman who lost her husband. Her husband gets the recognition and is also on the memorial because they found any DNA, but she also told that there were a lot of families who could not prove. And the consequence of that is that they didn't get any care, they didn't get any financial help, but also emotional. They were excluded, of course, because if somebody is not taking care of you, like the government or whatever, I think it's really hard in with this situation, because you're already lost a loved one, and then you also have to deal with this big problem. The other things is that they also were really scared to have contact with the government, because if your son or your daughter or your husband is still alive and you say, hey, he's missing, or I didn't have any contact. So yeah, so what I wanted to do is, first of all, I thought I have to find someone who experienced this. So I talked to Joe Magellan, and he was kind of this person,
liaison.
Yeah, you heard. He helped the families, the relatives, with this difficult thing, because he was this townsperson.
So you can't be confident?
Yeah. He was helping these families because the people were really scared to talk to the government, of course. And he did it together with the Red Cross. But of course it was really difficult because their families, they were living in Mexico. I just focused really on the Mexican community because searching the contact was more easy with them. And yeah, so for me, I thought how I am going to fit this in a work, because I decided it would be my graduation work. And what I'm gonna do? So first I wanted to make a book about it with all the research in it, with essays written by Joe Magellan and the professors of the NYU. But I was just running out of time, and I really felt that if I was making a book, it had to be really good with all the information in it. And sometimes you just need to reflect on your own work for you can bring it out in that kind of form. So actually, I think 5 weeks before I had to graduate, I decided that it had to be a video installation. First I thought, oh, maybe I should make a presentation on the wall. But this story is really intimate, and you really has to be focused on the story. And if you have a presentation on the wall, you could be easily get distracted or whatever. And I also really want to be big. So in real life, the real video installation is 8.5 meters wide, and you're kind of surrounded by it. So what I did is, look, if you are a photographer or a storyteller, we all want to tell a good story about people who we met. But I was really thinking, when am I doing the right thing? Am I doing the right thing if I just interview a mom who lost her son, for example, and making pictures of her or whatever? But I thought, no, I think I did not want to expose the real families to my project, because I don't think that's it, where it's about. I think that if I would do that, then there would be again a discussion if their stories are true, because a lot of people don't believe the stories. They think they say things because of the money or the financial or the claims. So I really wanted to tell the story, but I also wanted to keep out of the real family. So what I did, I collected all these stories and I made one fictional story based on the real stories, which is kind of a metaphor. So I really wanted that people could relate to the story. So now I'm telling you, and I don't know if anybody has seen my station, but it really had to be a narrative. And so I started with what I did is I talked a lot to Mexican people, of course a couple of families. I talked to Joel McGallen about this, and he knew everything about the families because he helped them. And I really wanted that it would be authentic. So I met this lovely guy in New York. He's also an undocumented immigrant. And I told him about my project and that I wanted to make it fictional based on the real stories. And I said, oh, I need pictures of a young Mexican boy. And he said, oh, okay, but you can use mine. I said, okay. Are you really okay with that? He said, yes, because, you know, I'm also undocumented and I live here in New York, and my place is, of course, he's just a working guy. And then he said, but I never can go out of New York. I can't do nothing. And for me, this is kind of, I'm also like an actor. So I was really humbled by the fact that he wanted to give his pictures and his family pictures. As I said, I wanted to make a narrative, and what I did is I also wrote a script after I interviewed people, and now it is this video installation, and you hear a mother talk about her son that she lost that day. So here you see his journey when he's going to New York. And when he's crossing the borders. And this is just the moment he arrives in New York. And this is actually, I made this picture in when I was in the New World Trade Center, because they built a New World Trade Center, and it's on the same height that I was there all day. Oh, sorry. And I really wanted to feel that people could relate to it, and it also felt real. And to me, it was really important to tell the whole story about it, actually. So this is the stuff the mother, this is the story about this guy who worked in the World Trade Center, and he lived with this roommates who were also undocumented Mexicans, and his friends searched for him for a week and they did not find him. So what they did was they sent the box with his stuff to his mom back to Mexico, and this was the stuff she received. What I also did, this guy actually, he's the name of the fictional person is Antonio, and what I did is I collected, because you have an official list, of course, for people who died, and I found also an unofficial list of a couple of Mexican people, approximately 100. So I chose a couple of names because Mexican people often have a lot of names, and I didn't want to be everything fictional. I really wanted to be also based on the truth. So I made this. His name is Antonio Arturo Hernandez, and these are names from the official list, but just only the first name or the middle name or the last name. And this guy, in the film, he's Antonio, but this picture actually is really made in the World Trade Center. I also met this guy, his name is Gino, and he's actually a survivor. He's an undocumented survivor. So I interviewed him, and I talked to him, and he was really kind to me, and he told me everything about that day. And he said, yeah, we were with a lot of colleagues, and after a week, we had this, we had to come to with an appointment with our employers, and a lot of people didn't come to the appointment, and so he knew a lot of his colleagues died, actually. And the point is of this project, I think the moral of the story is also that sometimes when you want to tell a story, you also have to think about how you present it and also about integrity. Because a lot of people say, oh, but it's fictional, so why you made it fictional? And for me, I think the integrity is somewhere else, is that if I can change something or whatever, and people want to tell their real stories, their stories are still authentic. But for me, I just want to point out that this happened, and I want the story of 9/11 to be more complete, because a lot of people don't know. And if you look at the memorial, you are very it's very impressive of it, impressive, because you see all these names, but there's not a spot for the unknown victims. And I think that's, yeah, for me that's really difficult to see, because I know all of this, and I hope it will change in the future. And the crazy thing is that all the remains they found and they could not match, they are now in the museum, in the 9/11 museum. They are buried in the repository, and it's behind a big mall. So if you are a family member and the body of your loved one couldn't be identified, and you want to go to the remains just to commemorate or whatever, you have to go in the museum downstairs to go to these remains. And so a lot of things are really strange to me. And I'm still not done with this project. I still want to make a book about it. So I'm also going back to New York to do more research and to put more things together. And sorry. I don't know, I think,
yes?
Go over to the questions.
Yeah. Are there any spontaneous memorials being set up by families still, or is it strictly reserved for the professionalized memorialization now at the 9/11 site?
At the site?
Yeah.
This is the answer. well, mostly the spontaneous memorials are online. Mm-hmm. But you have, you mean for the families I talk about?
Yeah.
Well, at the Mexican ambassade?
No, embassy.
Yeah, embassy, yeah. They do every year, they have their own memorial moment. And there's also a flag they found, a Mexican flag they found at Ground Zero. And I was really touched by the flag, because it was just this thing that survived. And they're not really spontaneous moments of to commemorate that. No. Yeah.
Did you show manage to show the film to some of the people who helped you make it? Or?
part of
yeah.
the story?
Yeah, I had to send it online, of course, because Joel, he was really touched about it because he talked to me and we had a real good conversation about it for I think 3 hours, and he said I put so much work in it to do the good things for all these families, and still there is almost nothing for them, and so he was also happy that somebody from Europe was just interested in do something with this topic.
Why 9/11 specifically? I know you seem like you're interested in pursuing a death-related topic, but what drew you just to cover 9/11 in your work?
So why I choose? I think I just bumped into it when I was doing this research. And actually, during this process, but maybe I can share it to you, because during this process, my mom died, and I was in the middle, and I was in New York, and they called me that I had to go home. And I just forgot what I just wanted to say. But I think what I want to say is that I'm not really related to 9/11, and I just bumped into this research. But because of all these people who died in my life, I could connect somehow, and I could say goodbye to my family, and I could say to my mom, I love you, and I could choose whatever happens on the funeral and chose the flowers. But these people, they couldn't. I mean, we talk about, there's a term, a bit ambiguous loss. I mean, the family's members, they did not have anything. They didn't have a death certificate, or they did not have any body remains to bury, or whatever. So I think because I've also been there in that process, and I had a lot of beautiful moments with my mom and with the rest of my family, I was, I think, more, even more touched by the fact that they didn't have nothing. So, yes.
Do you have the project somewhere online? You can see it.
Yeah, it's on my website. My teacher said, oh, you don't have to put the whole film online, because otherwise people in the art world don't want that, because but I think it's good to have it online and people can see just the whole film. And of course it's different because on the video installation is big and you feel this impact, but I think it's also, you get everything when you see it online. Yeah.
You say the website or
website. Oh, sorry.
What?
Yeah, it's just
Felicity. Yeah, we'll tweet it.
Okay. It's just felicityvanort.com. Yeah. So, are there any questions left?
When you decide to change to a video installation, you already took some movie shots? Or?
No, actually, it feels like a movie. But I only used the photography. And what I did, of course, so you see the screenshot, you see the panoramic view is moving. I made it like that in Premiere Pro. And but it feels more like a movie, but there are no moving, no videos in it.
Yes, I'm just curious, have you approached anyone at the, the real memorial in terms of like asking to display this work for the undocumented, or would that, I mean, I've never been there, I don't know what the space is like, but I would think this is pretty valid as far as for the rest of the world or for the other families, but
well, in the museum, they have this space with all this art, and I was there and I thought, oh, if my video to be there would be amazing, but I think this is really difficult because I think it's also about acknowledging things, and I don't know if they want to have it there. I mean, when I was busy with the selfie project, I also contacted the memorial, and the only response I get was, you're not allowed to film visitors at a desk here, so. So I was, but maybe, but of course I want to bring it to New York, and because I think it belongs there, not here. Of course, we all have our opinion about it, I think. But it would be great if it's there, so yeah, I'm definitely going to try to bring it to New York.
It reminds me, there's probably many of you don't remember this, but I was very, I wasn't affected by 9/11, but it was, you know, it's one of those days in my life I'll never forget and what I was doing. And for months afterwards, I would go to work and I would pull up the New York Times and I would read stories of all the victims because they did like a cameo of each person. I think every day there were like 10 new people. And I remember sitting at my desk just bawling. And I thought, I don't know these people. This isn't, you know, I'm not connected to them.
Yeah.
But just the size, the magnitude of this loss was, you know, such a huge thing for the country. And I mean, maybe that's another venue for sort of contacting them, because my guess is that's still going on, that families go visit that. You know, it's an online memorial as far as, well, it's becoming really, you know, this is the thing they do now, right? You know, you have a bunch of shooting victims and you put all the pictures and
yeah.
the story, but that's something that was maybe the first one
yeah.
of that scale. So.
Yeah, actually, I talked also with a couple of graphic designers about my project and about developing it. And maybe I think I want to make a book with a website, with an online memorial something, but not only you can write something down, really, yeah, a beautiful memorial online, because I think nowadays that what you said, it's really a thing to have.
Any other questions, or should we go?
One question. Did doing the project change the way you document your own memories now? Or would you have any advice for us to maybe document ours in a better way?
Of course it changed the way I look, and I'm a person who makes pictures of everything, and I'm filming and making pictures all day long, also from the people I love. But for example, I also documented my mother in there when she was sick, and it also changed my look, and it also changed the way I made work. Yeah, and I think one of the advices is don't feel forced to do it, of course, to collect all these memories, because I think memories are also great when you're not knowing you're making memories, and after a while you just remember these memories you have. But I think, yeah, you have to cherish what you have, and be really careful with the pictures you have. Don't throw them away. I think as a photographer, it really hurts my heart if people throw pictures away, because sometimes I'm just visiting these flea markets and then I found all of these albums with these family pictures in it. But I think you can do really cool things with it, if it's from your grandma or your grandfather or whatever, but just don't throw them away, I think. You can always throw them away, or your children after you died, or